Hi, I'm Sarvesh Kapoor. I work at IntelliCap in their investment banking division, and I help startups raise venture capital fund. In today's video, we would talk about the term sheet. What to expect in a term sheet, what are the key clauses that you should look out for, and how best to negotiate them. After an investment manager has done his business due diligence and is comfortable making an investment, he comes out with a formal proposal to make an investment into your company, which is called the term sheet. The term sheet typically has the valuation that the investors are willing to give to your company, the amount of investment that they are likely to make, as well as certain rights and obligations of the investor and the promoter. Before we get into the terms of the term sheet, it is very important to understand the term sheet is a non-binding legal agreement. That is to say that even if you execute the term sheet, you do not have any obligation to take the money from the investor, and neither does the investor have an obligation to put in money into your business. The investor may value your business as on today and decide on the stake he will take today itself, or postpone the valuation altogether in the future date and value your business depending on your performance in the future. One of the key rights that the investor asks for are called affirmative rights. These are nothing but a couple of corporate actions that the company can take only if the investor agrees for it. Typically, the investor invests far more amount of money in the business than the promoter has, and hence he would like to make sure that his money is protected. So for example, if the promoter wants to acquire another company, he would need to do so with this investment that the investor has made. And hence, the investor has to agree for this acquisition. Similarly, if the promoter wants to pay dividends or buy back certain shares, it is essential that the investor agrees to this decision. A few other affirmative rights examples include corporate governance issues, for example, appointment or changing of auditors, or entering into transactions with related parties. Affirmative rights are also typically given for making alterations to memorandums or articles of associations, which would affect the rights of the investors. They're also typically given when you want to enter a new line of business, in which case the investor definitely needs to be comfortable that a new line of business is going to be entered, and his money would also be used for that line of business. In an early stage investment, the investment manager is essentially taking a bet on the capabilities of the promoter. Hence, it is but natural to have a lot of restrictions on the transfer of shares of the promoters. The term sheet would also have certain restrictions on the transfer by the promoters. For example, before the promoter wants to sell any part of his stake, he would have to take a prior consent of the investment manager. Even after taking consent, there could be certain clauses that he cannot sell his stake to an outsider before offering that stake to the investment managers himself. So for example, if I am a promoter in a company and I have 75% stake left after this investment happens, and I want to sell say 5% of my stake, I may have to take the approval of the fund manager before I can sell this 5% stake. And even after I take the approval from the investment manager, the term sheet may have a clause that I have to offer this 5% stake to this fund itself and give them the first right to buy this. If they agree, they will buy the stake, and if they do not agree, only then can I sell this 5% to a third party. The term sheet would also have a clause called the tag-along rights that the investor would require. This is nothing but in case the promoter is selling a part of his stake, say for example 5% of his stake, to a third party, then the investor would also want to have a right to sell his 5% stake to the same third party in the same price and condition. It is essential to have a discussion with the investment manager and see if there could be a carve out of a small portion of your investment that you can sell without any of these transfer restrictions or tag along. So for example, if you discuss with the investment manager, they may allow say 5% of your stake to be sold without any of these transfer restrictions which the investment manager may have, and also without them tagging along when you're selling this 5% stake. This essentially makes sure that you can sell part of your stake and realize some amount of capital if you need that for any of your personal purposes. In order to protect their capital, the fund managers will also have a clause called the liquidation preference in their term sheet. This is nothing but the preference in which monies would be distributed in an event of liquidation. So say for example, the venture capital fund has invested 3 crores in your business and has only taken a 25% stake, whereas you have invested say 50 lakhs so far and have got a 75% stake. In the future, if your company goes into liquidation and it gets 2 crores from liquidation proceeds, and if you share it normally, then the investment fund will only get 25% of this, whereas the promoter gets a large chunk of this, which is 75%, which perhaps is a little skewed because of the amount of capital that the investment fund has put in, and hence the clause liquidation preference. Typically, the liquidation preference clause says that the fund's principal would be returned back before any money can be returned to the promoters of the company. So in continuing this example, since the fund had put in 3 crores and the proceeds that you got from liquidation were only 2 crores, the first 2 crores itself would be returned to the fund and the promoter unfortunately would not get anything else. However, continuing the same example, if during liquidation you get 5 crores, then the first 3 crores, which is the investor's capital, would be returned to the investors and the 2 crores can be distributed in a formula that is predetermined again at the time of the term sheet. Since the investment made by the investment manager is for a small period of time, typically 5 years, he would want his money back in this period. And this is one of the key clauses in the term sheet, the obligation of the promoter or the company to return back the capital of the investment fund. So typically in the term sheet you have clauses like in the first 5 years itself the company will try to go IPO in order to give the return back to the fund. In case the IPO is not possible in the first 5 years, then there would be a buyback which the company would do in the future. The most favorable exit option for an investor is the IPO. However, a startup in the social enterprise space is unlikely to get into that size in 5 years period where it can be an IPO-able. Hence, the investors look at other modes of exit in a 5-year window, which they like to document in the term sheet also. The other way in which the investment manager would look at an exit is a secondary sale of shares. That is, it would expect the promoter to find another investor who is willing to buy the stake of this investor. Or also in the future, when there are future rounds of fundraising, he would mention that some portion of those future rounds is kept aside to buy back or purchase the stake of the current investment. The other option that the investment manager may also look at is a buyback that the company may need to provide. Say for example, in this 5-year period, the secondary sale has not happened. Then the investment manager would expect the company to buy back the shares what the investment company has at this point of time. Even if this is not possible, for instance, that there is not enough of money that the company generates after 5 years to give them an exit through a buyback, then the investment manager would want to look at options where he himself finds players who are willing to buy the company. And he also may have a clause called a drag-along clause on the promoter. So say for example, if there is no possible exit that the investment has got in this 5-year period, then the investment manager goes out and looks for someone who is willing to buy this company. At that point of time, the investment company may hold in this could be as small as 10% or 15%, and the remaining could be with the promoters or any other investors as well. And a strategic investor who is willing to buy this company may obviously not want to buy just 10-15% stake, and he may want to buy anything between 51% to 100%. However, the investment company that we are talking about right now who's investing may have just 10-15% stake, as we mentioned. So the drag along clause, what it has is nothing but it says that it will force the promoters at that point of time to sell their stake also to the strategic investor. If the strategic investor wants 51% of stake, then the balance comes from the promoters, and if he wants 100% of stake, then he's dragging along not just the promoters, but perhaps even the other investors. Let's understand this drag along clause slightly in more detail. So say, for example, after this 5-year period, the exit has not been provided. So the investment manager does find a strategic player who's willing to buy the stake in this company. But at that point of time, the investment manager or the investment fund stake in this company could only be 15%, and the remaining could be with the promoters. And the strategic player who's willing to buy may be interested to buy the company only if he gets a majority stake. He may be interested to buy 51% right up to 100%. However, of course, the fund only has 10 to 15% of stake which they can offer. So in this scenario, he will drag along with himself the promoter's stake in this company so that the strategic investor gets the stake what he desires. So for example, continuing, if he wants 51% of stake and the investment management has 15% stake, then the balance is what he would ask the promoters to sell along with himself. And if the strategic player wants 100% of the company, then he would ask the entire amount of the balance, which is of course the full shares of the promoters, also to be sold along with him. One of the other clauses to look out for in the term sheet is a clause which mentions who is going to take care of the expenses related to the due diligence as well as documentation post the term sheet stage. It is highly likely that the term sheet that you get initially would have a clause which would say that the company has to bear all these expenses. However, you need to look at it once again and go back to the investment manager and negotiate this clause. Typically, it is quite fair to have a percentage of say 1% or 2% of the investment amount that the company is receiving to be paid as these expenses. And also what you should negotiate is whether you would still need to pay these expenses if ultimately the fund does not invest in your business. It is also very common for the investor to ask for board seat in the investee company. He would want to have a representation in the board so that any strategic decision that is taken along with his consent, as explained earlier. Here it is also very important to understand a concept called minimum equity participation, which you should negotiate with the investor. What this is that once the investor's stake in the company fall below a threshold, say for example 5%, then various rights like appointment of a member in the board seat or various affirmative rights should fall away. And this is something that you should negotiate, because going forward there would definitely be more than one or two investors in your company if you raise further capital, and giving these rights even to shareholders who have just 1 or 2% stake in the company may be very difficult to manage in the future. The investment could be in the form of a straight equity, which is that both you and the investment manager agree upon a stake that they would get today. Or it could be in a convertible structure, which means that the valuation of your company would be determined at a later stage depending on what you've been able to achieve till that date. In this video, we have covered the key clauses in the term sheet and what do they mean. I hope this video has given you enough knowledge to understand a few other terms in the term sheet itself. In the next video, we will talk about the accounting and legal due diligence along with the shareholders' agreement and other documentation.